Okay, Ward, we're going to go ahead and get started with the deconstruction of your watch. Get your movement taken apart here so we can start the service. Lots and lots of extra grease here that really doesn't need to be on this. Sometimes people get a little bit overzealous. Alright, before we get too far, I'm going to go ahead and take your movement out of your case here. Never like to interact with dials without a little protection from my fingers. The greases that are on them can be a problem. So what we can also do is we can check the originality of your dial here with your case. And so Seiko stamped most of the backs of dials. So this has a 5-0, and your case back has a 5-0. So same day or same month, same year. So this is the original dial to this watch. That's reassuring. All right, so nice original watch. Okay, put that safely away. Go ahead and there you go. Very clean looking day and date wheel. You got a slight crease right here in your day wheel. I don't think that's really bothering anything, but it's definitely there. Overall, looks pretty clean. Sometimes those creases can come in as people who do service push on that area and it's super thin, and that can lead to some slight distortion of that plate. You gotta be a little careful with that because it can rub over time. Okay, so let's go ahead and take off your jewel here. Stuck in there. Let's just take a little bit of Rotico and pull it out. There we go. Not my favorite method, but it tends to work. Okay. Let's go ahead and take your balance off. Yep. Take your chronograph bridge off. This is a 6139B movement. There are some not insignificant differences between the A and the B, but they're not that different, other than a few minor things. Part of them is associated with this bridge. We'll take a very close look at your bushings here. And it's egged out just a little bit. Seems that this watch had been reset a few times. You can tell that from this bushing right here. This bushing here can tend to get a little bit distorted, but that's okay. There's not a, it's not part of the timekeeping mechanism per se. It's mostly just to do with the advancement of the chronograph. Here's your chronograph minute recording wheel. Okay, and you got some springs here to take apart. That's one for your hammer return. There goes your hammer. This resets your chronograph minute counting wheels. Here's your spring for your chronograph engagement components. And these are your chronograph engagement arms. Give that a little push, open these up. Okay. All right, off we come. Bushing right here. You don't want to lose that. Your chronograph arm. And screw. Okay. I'll go ahead and take your ratchet wheel off. Okay, now we take your train bridge, have that off. Three screws. Okay, now for the most important piece in this movement right here. Your chronograph wheel. Give it a quick little brush test. Yeah, that's in good shape. At least at first glance, that seems really quite good. Here's your third wheel. Let's take off your pallet bridge. Okay, here's your pallet fork. Wow, lots and lots of lubricant underneath of that bridge. I'm going to take a close look at your pallet fork, make sure that it's in good shape. As soon as I find my loop. Looks okay. First glance, not too bad. Put that over here. Okay, now we can take your escape wheel. And your barrel. Woo! Yeah, so you can see here, there's lots of rubbing. That's where your new jewel is gonna go, right here. Okay, so let's go ahead. Take off your bridge, your cock for your center wheel. That'll come out in a moment. Man, there is a ton of grease under here. This is just really, really over-lubricated. Looks like somebody dipped it in grease. Okay. All right, now for your calendar side. Make sure your dial screws are in place. Okay. There we go. Okay, let's go ahead and take your day wheel. All right. How interesting. How very interesting. I have never seen. This is a different style than I'm used to. This day finger here. I've not seen that before. One that locks in directly. Huh. I wonder if that's correct. Whether somebody just had one to put on. But it's okay. I mean, it probably does the trick. But still, it's very different than what I normally see on the 6319 or 6139s. Okay. Okay. I'll hold these screws and this plate to the side. Actually, we're going to revisit this one when we go to put your new mainspring arbor port jewel in. We will actually put this back into place as a guide to help us with the machining process of those components, along with your other bridge here, which is this minute wheel bridge. So there's your 12-hour wheel. That's actually what your hour hand connects to. There's your intermediate wheel. There's your date wheel. Jumper. Okay, let's go ahead and take this advancing wheel. Jewel out. There we go. Take your can and pinion off. There we go. Now we can take your keyless works apart. We're going to leave this in place so we can do our machining. Center wheel. Okay, and that's your movement torn down. We are going to get started on cleaning, and then we're going to get it back together after we do some machining. All right. Okay, Ward, we're going to get started on the reconstruction process here of your movement. Couple things to talk about before we go. So I just want to point out you've got two new jewels. One is here. This is your lower mainspring arbor port. This is where your mainspring resides. This is for your upper mainspring arbor port, this jewel here. So these two jewels are new for your movement. And those are the things that I discussed before where the barrel can wobble badly if you are not careful to make sure that those are right. One other slightly concerning thing is when I do my tests for all your components, I look very closely, especially at this. This is your, what's effectively your fourth wheel and your chronograph wheel. And there are some springs that are associated with this that keep everything in place as your chronograph is operating. Now, it looks to me like one of these springs has sort of bent a bit, and I'm not sure if that's gonna affect operation at all. And perhaps I can show you what that's going to look like. This is a little difficult to do, so I'm going to try and do it as best I can. But there should be a flat spring. Do you see it perhaps raised up a little bit? Yeah, that spring right there that's raised up off that flat surface, that is worrisome. I say that because buying one of these is a bad amount of money. It's actually really quite expensive, and so I'm hopeful that this will work as we put things back together. No promises, of course, and I'll have to be in touch with you about that if it is bad. But we're gonna cross our fingers and hope for the best. Hopefully, it's not a it's not as bad as a broken chronograph wheel. They are essentially the cost of a watch to replace. So we're going to keep our fingers crossed, and we're going to go for it and see what we get. So now I'm going to start with the reassembly process. And that means we have to do some lubrication, of course. So you did not have to replace your mainspring. It was in good shape. There's your center wheel in place. And your mainspring barrel. Okay, now we build out your gear train. third wheel. And this is your, yeah, everything seems good. Okay, now let's see. We won't really know until we get the watch put back together whether or not this is going to be a problem. No way to really tell a priori. It was running before. I just hope it disengages as it should and that piece stays in place. So we'll take a very close look as we get going. Okay, so now that we've got your train wheels in place, we can put your train bridge in place. Align so they go in their jewels and bushings. Looks good. Get these just in contact so we don't potentially pinch any of your elements that might be slightly out, but I don't think we're there. I can see the ends of your. Looks good. Okay, so your train looks good. All right, let's go ahead and get your click in place. Okay, so that's your components of your train built. Now we have to do some lubrication before your plate goes back on. So we're gonna lubricate your wheels and your pivots. Okay. Now we go ahead and put your in place. Mm-hmm. now we're going to build out your chronograph components. First we start, of course, with lubrication on your pivot points. We also have to lubricate the actual arms themselves. Gap comes a contact, so we put some lubrication here. That's good. Okay. And get your screws in place. Your lever. This face here requires a bit of lubrication. Alrighty, let's go ahead and put your ring and we'll lubricate that. Oops. Wheel needs to go on top. You got to make sure that these levers are correctly positioned. There we go. Bring back this spring a bit. Screw. And some lubrication around the edges. Now we put your hammer in place. And it gets its spring. It's always a bit delicate, but you sort of get used to it. There we go. Looks a little bent on this side, but I think that's all right. Holds it down. That's good. Okay, one more spring here for your arms. And there we go. Okay. Clean up up here. All right, now we need your intermediate wheel and your minute recording wheel. Aligned with each other, should be good. All right, so there are your chronograph components built out. And now we need your chronograph bridge. Make sure that that's well lubricated as well. Good. Yep. Okie dokie. Go ahead and get some screws. Oops, in place. There's one. Bring this over. There we go. Wonderful. Okay. Now we need to flip your train and lubricate and get your cannon pinion in place. Right. Okay. Let's lubricate under your cannon pinion here. Your die shock settings in place on this side so that when we drop the balance in place, we have this ready to go. So this is placed on top, and then we get our oiler. Okay, let's check it. Perfect. Okay. Now. Now we have to your spring in place to make sure that that's held as it should be. Of these two jewels. So there's one, and there's the other. Okay, so that's enough for the calendar side for the moment. Let's switch back to the train side. Okay, so next is to put your fork in place. Pallet fork goes in. We're gonna lubricate it first. Fork lubricated, and we'll get it installed. We'll check your function here. Sorry about that. Touch of power into your mainspring to make sure that moves good. Okay. Next one. Good. Let's put some power in your mainspring here. Ready? Good. That's a good sign. All right, let's go ahead and lubricate your upper die shock setting. Be prepared to install your mainspring. Balance. Oops. Come on. did. See how your hairspray does. There we go. We have life. That's one. Okay, we're back together. I want to check your chronograph function here. I see it going around, so that's in the disengaged position. Let's see if it looks okay. Okay. Okay, so these are your starting numbers. It's where we're gonna start doing some tuning. Should be. So let's take care of your beat error. It's always a guessing game of which way to go. Start. That might have been too much in one direction. Let's go back. Yep, there we go. Pretty close. and see. Alright, I'm pretty happy with that as a start. We're going to let this run in a little bit, let all the lubrication sort of find its way around. But as a first few minutes, being a functioning watch, I think these numbers are looking pretty good. Two 20s to begin with is sort of where you want to be. So we're gonna let this run in a bit and get itself sorted out and see how we do. Okay. Okay, Ward. Your movement's running really strong here, so I'm really happy with the way it's looking right now. I went ahead and reconstructed your case and put things back together. Just a very light cleaning with some soapy water. Brought it up really beautifully. This hasn't even been touched by anything like a rag or, you know, it's just been cleaned. Got your new crystal in, so that's nice and clean, perfect, no scratches. One thing I do want to point out, and I'm not sure if you can see this properly, but your stem has some very slight, I think it might even be in the crown, has a bend. Now, that's not normally a big deal, and you probably didn't notice it. These watches don't necessarily wind, so you're not going to see a problem with winding. Mm-hmm. This will set, of course, the time and also turn your bezel. However, what may happen, and we'll check this very closely, what often does happen is that pivot point will tend to move your movement around just a little bit. Now, investing in a new one, I can't straighten them. They will just crack immediately. They're a hardened kind of steel. So I generally don't do that. You would have to replace either the stem or the crown. And I'm a little hesitant to just get into that simply because it might not be so dramatic that you would notice. I'll take a close look at it once I start getting the case back together with the movement and everything. But now we're going to go ahead and get started in putting your movement's final pieces back together, get the calendar side built out, and we're going to go from there. Okay, so let's get started. Okay. Sorry for the noise. My dogs like to keep me company here in the workshop. All right, first thing to do is, of course, lubrication on all the pivot points here. In place. We'll build out all the important pieces here. There's your intermediate wheel and its retaining plate. place. Go ahead and lubricate our wheel and your can and pinion. Now for your turnover wheel for your day and date. With your very interesting wheel that goes on top, which I have not seen before. Somewhat unique to me, at least. Seems to do the trick, but not one that I'm familiar with. Gets a shouldered screw. Holds everybody down, but doesn't hold everybody from turning. So that should now turn together. Okay, now we build out your calendar. I mean your keyless works. So all of those get a little bit of lubrication in the form of some nice synthetic grease. All of these high friction points here and here, they all get a bit of lubrication, make sure that there's no issues. So this is part of your quick date change setup. It's part of these movements. All right, come back. Clean that up in a moment. I also like to lubricate this pin here. Sees quite a bit of motion. Okay, let's go ahead and get your stem and your winding pinion, even though there's no winding in this movement. I'm gonna lubricate these gears here, these teeth. Go ahead and lubricate your stem. A little there, a bit there, some inside of there, and there we go. Ready to put that in place. On your winding pinion. Here's your yoke, which ingeniously Seiko made into a spring as well, so there's fewer components, which is cost saving and makes for easier manipulation for doing service. Lubricate your setting lever. Oops, there goes your yoke. Right, let's just make sure that everybody's where they should be. Okay, that's good. Alright, let's back in place. This big friction point here. Okay. Okay. And there we go. Let's get your screws in place. Such an ingenious design process to remove all of these weird little springs that generally were in keyless works and other components for time setting and date setting. By Seiko, they just came out with these brilliant little stamped components that just do the trick. No fuss and no difficulty, no tiny little pieces of spring flying all over the place. Just makes it so much nicer to work on. Some of the much earlier movements of the same design, they just refined it to the point where they were able to remove out all that complexity, which is exactly what you want to do as an engineer. Keep the function and remove complexity. Okay. So there's that. Now we're ready to get your calendar components in place. That means we need another spring without a spring. So just a stamped component that works. It doesn't add to the complexity. All right. So here's your date ring. Right into place. Put a little tiny lubricant on the end of that jumper. There we go. Okay, now for your retaining plate. And this also has built within it, the spring that retains the day wheel in place. Again, an ingenious design. Seiko just really knew what they were doing. So many different ways. Alright, looks good. Happy with that. Okay, now go ahead and check. Yep, that seems to work just fine. Let's go ahead and put your day wheel back on. Like I said, what you have to be careful about with this is that you don't add any pressure when you're trying to put it in place that's unnecessary. Because what you can end up doing is bending that piece. So I generally use a toothpick with very light pressure, or a piece of what we call peg wood. So I push here and ever so gently manipulate that spring, and there it is. No drama. Again, making sure everything is as it should be. Okay, your C-clip goes on with the bevel side down so that you can remove it again in the future. That's exactly as it should be. All right, there we go. That functions perfectly. Okay, pretty happy with that. Okay, Ward, we have reached a pretty fun point of the reconstruction here. So now I'm gonna go ahead and put your watch back in its case. Couple little things just to point out. You know, your dial looks pretty good. I was able to get some of the haze off of your hands. Just to note, you know, your dial has slight damage here and there. It's no big deal. You have one small little scratch that was there, and some minor issues, as you know, with the black material that it tends to be just the interaction of moisture with the material that makes up the lacquer of the surface here. So all of your functionality is there. Looks like everything's working just fine with your chronograph wheel. I haven't seen any issues, but I'm going to give you some warnings towards the end once we get everything finished up and buttoned up about how to properly use the chronograph on this watch, just as a way to kind of guide you as you enjoy your awesome 6139. Okay, so I'm going to start by putting the watch back in the case, and then we're going to build out the last few components, and we'll be all set. All right, so let's watch this function. So this is going to come over at the sweep of 1 minute, and you should record a minute here on your minute recording wheel. So let's watch that happen, and there it goes, clicks right into place. Okay. Flipped over. All right, here we are. Now, what we're going to do is build your winding, self-winding. So these are all automatics. There's no winding in this watch at all other than what the winding weight does. So when you pick it up and it's not running, what you have to do is you have to actually physically shake the watch to wind it. And that adds power to the mainspring, which then makes your watch go. Okay, so last few components here. It has an ingenious winding system which uses what's called a pawl lever that engages a reduction gear here, which we're going to lubricate and put into place. So this gets a few drops around the circumference, just to make sure that it's nice and easy. There we go. And now we're gonna lubricate your winding assembly and your ball bearings. Okay, the pawl lever goes here. nice here. Everybody's engaged exactly as they should be. All right, let's go ahead and get some excess off. Put one more drop. There you go. And now go ahead and place the screws. Now your winding weight, which is nice and clean. Let's make sure there's no dust or debris going in. Final screw. That we are ready to seal up your watch. All right, Ward, we have reached the end of the process here. So let's go ahead and get your case back, put back on. All right, here we go. Brand new seals on all your pushers and your crown. Go ahead and get your watch set here. Looks just so spectacular. All right. Align your rotating ring. Let me just get your surfaces cleaned up just a touch here. All right, Ward, with that, we are finished with the service of your watch. This is quite a beautiful piece, I have to say. So, what we're doing is full service, so your dial here. I didn't do anything outside of just making sure it had no dust and no component, no contamination. I did clean up your Seiko just a little bit here, just to get the shine back, and I think that came out really nice. I went ahead and got the water haze off of your hands. I think they came out really nice, and they really show their age nicely. You know, everything else is as it should be. Your chronograph wheel, thankfully, is working just as it should. So that's always a plus. You never want to have that end up needing something. New seals everywhere. What I want to show you is that whenever you're running the chronograph, and it's okay to run the chronograph on this watch all the time. In fact, you can use it as a sweep second if you want to. What you really do want to do, though, is if you do run it and you want to stop it to bring it back to the straight up and down position, you always want to stop and do a reset somewhere between 11 and 1, never from down here, simply because there's a lot of torque that gets put on all the components as you do reset it. And so I'm going to get it really close, and then you give it a quick push and you reset. I just think this really came out stunning. I didn't do any polishing, simply just cleaning on the watch. The numbers are phenomenal. What I do want to do, though, is I want to show you, if you do set the time, luckily there's no wobble in the dial. sometimes when you have a bent stem or a bent crown, you can end up with some wobble in there. And luckily, you're in good shape. There's no issue. So that's always a plus. Okay, so your bracelet cleaned up nicely. Just to show you here, I'm going to go ahead and put it back on your watch. You have a little bit, I think somebody tried to do some crimping here on this. So this is a slide out extender piece. And I think that somebody had tried to do some work on that at one point, but that's okay. It's a nice original bracelet. It looks really good. I cleaned it up. Everything came out really well. So I'm just extremely happy with this. You know, it's a great watch. It looks just beautiful. So thanks again, and I'll send you this video, and we'll get your watch back to you. All right, thank you. Lord, I just wanted to give you a sense of what your numbers look like. Here we are running just perfectly in the 230s. I think this is exactly where we want to be. You know, just absolutely phenomenal running watch. I think you're going to be really happy with this one for a long time. I just moved the watch, so it's going to jump around a little bit. But overall, you know, this is exactly what you want to see a 6139 running at. 230 to 240 is really a great, great place to be. So, all right, we're doing good. Very, very accurate. No beat error. This is exactly as you want it. Thanks a lot.